друзья, ну, мы завершаем Evolution Solo Weekend 2018. I will switch to English so everybody understands what I'm saying. Everybody understands what I'm saying. First of all, thank you for coming. And we finish this with traditional Sunday talk. So we hope you prepared your questions to, I think, the best, the dream lineup that we have right here. It's Annelys, Perez, Castillo. Put your hands together, please. Mr. Frankie Martinez. Dennis Adu. And Professor Thomas DeFrantz. And I also want to say, there is an online transmission. I want to say hello to Josette Wigan, who is unfortunately not with us. But Josette, we love you and we are with you here, so yeah. Borders doesn't mean anything to us right now. So, yes, and I want to thank everybody, and I hope you prepared your questions. I want to warn that we don't have translation, interpretation into Russian on Sunday talks traditionally, because otherwise we will leave at 5 a.m. So, and I know usually we talk a lot, yeah, so we want to discuss everything. So you can poke your neighbors, like, what is that word? Does it mean? Okay, like, help me to understand, you know. Or just raise your hand. Okay, so here we go, and I want to introduce Valera. Valera, do you have a mic? Valera Bulavka, please put your hands together for Valera. Yeah,
thank you so much.
He is our traditional and host of Evolution, yeah, like, Solo Weekend.
Yeah, you know, like, Evolution Solo Weekend is a big festival now, you know, and Alina, actually, Alina, of course, I'm pretty happy that Alina invited me to be kind of like a mediator or host, but my general role here is just to maybe ask a couple of questions and just hold the microphone, basically. But yeah, but the festival is so big now and so full of resources that she actually paid for my flight. And yes, pay for my flight, for the hotel room, for everything, you know. Это шутка. Well, that's a joke. But I don't know. Like, let's start. And I have a first question that maybe I should ask Professor DeFrantz. I'm curious about your tap dancing. Actually, it was pretty impressive. And my question would be, what do you think of tap dance as part of black dance? You know, something like this.
Yeah, we need, I guess. Thank you so much. And again, just thanks to Alina and Fedor and everyone who's helping making the technology work and happen and bringing the boards out and manning the bar. It just makes the whole event really special, and I'm very appreciative to be here. So we go into the question, though. I think what we know when we're interested in swing dancing is that tap is the form, is the formal sort of structural device that helps us understand how to have rhythmic address in swing. So tap develops before, alongside, but kind of before, certainly before swing dancing, but alongside the cakewalk and early forms of Black American vernacular dance. And tap, like, organizing rhythm is the basic feature of Black musicality, how you can organize rhythm. Because if you can change the beat, you can change the world. And in dancing, in these dances, we learn how to reorganize and restructure time. And if you can time, well, then we could all do better. Do that. Nice. Well, okay, just take that out, sorry. So I think that, you know, tap dance, because it's built upon the manipulation of rhythm and time, it's foundational to all of these dances in a certain way that we're thinking about. Even in the Orisha dances, how we organize rhythm matters. So tap is the explicit kind of thinking about rhythm, organizing rhythm, and rhythmic address. So, you know, when we think about Frankie Manning and Norman Miller, they were all, you know, all these swing dancers and Lindy Hoppers were tap dancers. I mean, it was, they went together. You couldn't do one without the other. So it's important that tap is part of a festival like this to help keep it making its space so that we're thinking about rhythm alongside all the other kinds of dancing we're doing.
All right. Yeah, thank you so much. Okay, everybody's encouraged to ask these people everything, every question that comes, like pops up in your mind, and you have a great opportunity here to ask anything that you were curious about, but were afraid to ask about the thing called black dance.
Hi. My question is, in two words, is how actually dance styles appear and evolve and take their place on the scene. And I mean, when I look at the different dance styles which exist or existed, it's like there was, for example, mambo, and then, for example, pachanga, and then boom, reggaeton, and then something else, or maybe there was some Lindy Hop, and then blues, rock and roll, and boom, twist. And what was in there somewhere in the beginning? What was between, for example, some street dance and walking, or how, for example, quadrille has appeared? I can imagine some picture, like some family was inventing in their mansion this weird dance, but how did it happen that people all over the world started dancing the same thing?
I know we have other people who can participate too. But this is, you know, it's such a great question, and it's at the heart of what I'm, you know, trying to do in research. And the way to think about the how is the relationship to the political circumstance always. So when we think about Lindy Hop develops as Black Americans are, you know, in the after the First World War are able to move from the South to the North, and the cities grow because there's a big migration, it's a big mass migration in the United States. And in that migration, people find ways to connect and communicate. Maybe the most important thing about these musics and dances is they're always about connecting and communicating and building relationships. And I know I said that on Thursday, but I want to stress that again, that these forms in the Black tradition of art making, it's about connecting, expression, and relationships. It's not about the aesthetic features. So these forms are not built upon what belongs and what doesn't belong. This is much more of a European point of view. I'm not saying anything's wrong or bad. I'm not saying that. But in the African and the Black traditions, the connections and the expression are what are most important. So you always have a political circumstance that produces the possibility for the dances. And in the Lindy Hop and swing, what happens is there's a mass migration from the South to the North. The South is very difficult for Black people. It still is in the United States. It gets better and better, but it's still very complicated. So as people are moving North, then they need new forms of music to celebrate and to share among each other. And spaces like this one would be a space in a city in the North. There would be no space like this in a city in the South. So in this space, we have maybe a band that's very loud in the corner, and the sound is bigger, and the city is more lively, and the dancing becomes more lively to match the kind of sound and energy of the cities. So swing and Lindy Hop are people who come from rural areas where things are slower and quieter into the big cities, and then make music and dances that match the experience of living in the city. So the music gets very animated, it gets very active. So this is a way to think about how it's relating to the social circumstance where the people live. The moving to the big cities produces the ground for swing and then for the Lindy Hop. And it's about this kind of acceleration, moving quickly above the ground. The way the lindy hop is very different in some ways from blues dancing, where the lindy, you're floating along the ground and moving fast. And it's more like what it is to be in a big city like New York or Chicago or Philadelphia, where you have to move fast among the crowd in order to find your way. So the dances always respond, the music and the dance respond to a social circumstance. They're also expression. So one way to understand them better is to think about the social circumstances that surround the production of the dances, like what was happening and when people are making the decisions and producing these new musics and new dances, what was happening for them. So that's just one way to think about it. And then we could do that with, voguing or kind of any form. We can think about what surrounds the people who are making the form, what was in their lives and that produced it. This movie Rise by David LaChapelle, where he talks about crumping and films crumping as it was happening in Los Angeles. It's pretty good helping us remember what life is like for people living in, East LA and Compton, in the parts of Los Angeles that are very difficult. And these dances and the music are very powerful ways to kind of express in the circumstance of what life is like in that part of Los Angeles. So I don't know if that helps answer, but it's a way to start thinking about how these dances and musics come together.
So the point is, which is still missing for me, how does it happen that people all over the world doing the same thing, how does it spread? Like, dancing is not contagious, it's not a disease, so how come that everyone is doing twist or everyone is doing quadrille?
Yeah, thank you again, it's a great question, I see. And actually there are several philosophers or cultural anthropologists or professors who do talk about dance and contagion. You know, dance as contagion. And there are many moments in our history, European history in different parts of Africa, in the US, where dance was described as being contagious. But, and this will be a little weird, but let me try for a minute. When we think about neurobiology now, that we actually have mirror neurons in our brains that fire when we see someone else do something. So if I see you do something, then my neurons fire and they tell my body to do it. This is human biology and it's how we are, protect ourselves. So if I see you run away, then I run away too. Dance operates in the same way. So if I see a dance, then I instinctively want to try to do it. So that's neurobiology. So maybe we don't believe that, but it's part of it, part of the story. In terms of Black social dances though, they're always so incredibly spectacular. And I think this is the thing that makes them so appealing to people all over the planet. These dances are produced in spaces of urgency because the circumstance for Black life is very complicated in the US. And then, so we have it's complicated living, but then we have expressive culture that thrives in music and dance. It's water and air for Black people, music and dance. And I'm not trying to naturalize it, but there's some truth in it. It's like water and air. It's like, I told you the story of my nephew's graduation. For the wedding party to come in, everyone had to show their own dance. Like, that's just how the wedding was organized. And this is a normal wedding. This is not unusual. Everyone dances in before the ceremony happens. So dance is really important. And then there's an urgency to how complicated life is. And so the dances that get produced are very captivating. They're spectacular. They're amazing. And each iteration from the cakewalk, it was amazing. And then the Lindy is amazing. And the Charleston and the twist, it's amazing. And b-boying and b-girling and floorwork, it's amazing. And then voguing, it's amazing to see it. And you watch these dances and you go, wow, I didn't know that, a body could do that. It's amazing what happens in these dances. So they're very attractive. And now we can see the dances more and more quickly. You can see them like 5 hours later or maybe 2 seconds later, or maybe at the same time through streaming and technology. So then they move more quickly now than ever before, from one place to other parts of the world. So maybe it's not a great answer, but it's an answer that tries to connect how the spectacularness of Black social dances is tied to political circumstance, and also in a real belief in music and dance as being life-affirming. Like, we need music and dance in order to live. We need music and dance in order to live. And so these dances are urgent, and then we make spectacular urgent dances that are appealing to people around the planet. You know, this is how I would try to start to answer this question.
Еще вопросы?
I'm sorry, it's again, Tommy is again, I will make you speak, sorry. Great. We know that you have projects that are a performance project and contemporary, not dance, but contemporary art, I would say. Can you comment a little bit on this, and also your projects about connecting dance and technology, and like these things? It's very interesting for me, I hope for everybody as well.
Yeah, I make these, so in my own practice, my connection to your communities of swing and blues and Latin and salsa dance is very new for me. These are new connections. My own work is mostly in experimental contemporary performance, you know. So I do tap dance, but it's experimental performance with technology. And I run a laboratory at a big university in the United States, and this is what we do. We make interfaces and make unusual performance projects, but telling stories about Black people's lives, like, that's in our mission. That's the most important thing that we do. And we produce conferences and books and workshops and classes and other things like this. So I'm always doing this work, and it's very exciting to me. I was a computer geek and nerd when I was younger, and I still do programming. So I'll show something. Do you want? Yeah, okay. I'll show something here. So this one maybe is fun because I know it's here and it should work. This is an interface that we made maybe 4 years ago. And the interface, the way it works is it's not a film in the background. There's a camera. So you'll see I'll bring a camera out, and the camera watches my movement. And then there are words on the wall. And these are like the words that you might say when you saw someone, you know, like queer or mixed race or Catholic, or just a label you might put on someone. And so those words dance, they dance in relationship to the movements that I do. It's not a film. It's actually in real, it's real-time processing. And so this is, let me just show this. So this camera I set up, and then the projection is live, and it follows my movement. We work on these different interfaces. In this one, that's a Kinect, which is the device from the Xbox, and we've rewired it to watch a dancer and then talk to a program that produces the mapping of the words. And we do different kind of experiments like this and make pieces. Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting. I have actually a question to Frankie Martinez. I have a privilege to be a part of this these Sunday talks for Evolution Solo Weekend for a number of years for now. So I remember that you were talking about your idea, some of your ideas, to kind of elevate salsa and Latin Caribbean dance to the point when it would be respected as like fine art, you know. And I'm just curious, can you like share us some achievements that are done in this field, you know, because like from your personal performance, you know, achievements and institutions, you know, that do that, you know, like, yeah, because it's taking shape all the time. I know it's a big thing. It's a huge process, but yeah, what's been happening?
Yeah, absolutely. I formed a company, a dance company, in 2000 called the Abaqua for Latin Dance Company. And my experience with Latin dance up until that point was mainly in a cabaret format where we were accompanying a band. And the extent of the choreography and the composition of the choreography was either in a short format, a few minutes, 3-4 minutes that the song lasted, alone with a company, or accompanying a band where we would have moments in the progression of the song where it was appropriate for dancers to be present. Because we don't just, people do this now, but there's an etiquette to accompanying a band because there's a song structure that's happening in Latin music. And how come the baby starts doing that when I'm... There she is. I'm stimulating the child. You see what happens? So, you know, during the Montuno section of the song, which is where we have the pregones, the call and response between the lead singer and the backup vocalist, or between the lead singer and instruments. During that section is kind of off limits. Like you wouldn't come out and dance and take attention away from what the musicians are doing at that moment. That's also where all the solos would happen in that section of the song. And so, you know, in that context, you're limited because you're vying for attention, or you're trying not to overstep the attention allotment, taking that away from the band. So anyway, that all was limited. That's all I experienced until I kind of was exposed to contemporary dance theater and even ballet companies that were Latin-based, like Ballet Hispanico, that had and still do incorporate some of Latin dance's history into what they're doing, but it's in a ballet format. And I always felt like it was not necessarily the representation of the real nitty-gritty stuff. And I felt that there was potential for that stuff to have the same artistic impact, but with the cultural respect that I felt was necessary to really pay proper homage to the dance form, right? Because it was like, when I was coming up, my manager would tell me that I had to take jazz classes, jazz you know what I'm talking about, right? Jazz like Broadway shows, jazz, right? I had to take jazz classes, I had to take contemporary classes, and I rejected that, right? And I would tell him that that Latin dance was complete as it was, and I didn't to add to the paradigm that it wasn't valid unless it had European influence and European validation. That bothered me as a Puerto Rican young man born in New York. I felt that the art form was set. It was that we partook of the art form on the street and the nightclubs, and it wasn't ever kind of properly put on a stage where the entire world could appreciate the artistic and cultural value inherent in the thing. We weren't giving them a chance to experience it that way. And so what you ended up with was these stereotypes of Latin dance, which is basically sexy. And this exists to this day, being propagated by everybody, right? I was in Greece and a woman told me, she said, why don't you allow the women to wear heels? And I explained to her about the connection to the ground and using your feet properly and producing movement from the ground. And she said, yeah, but it's salsa, you're supposed to wear heels. This is a Greek woman in Athens telling a Puerto Rican from New York what wasn't salsa, but that's beyond the point. But she then said, you know, you have to be sexy. And it blew my mind to hear her say that. And it was offensive, but it was also sad at the same time that's what the concept was relegated to. It was that it was sexy. Latino sexy. Every time you see Latin dance in a movie, it's dirty dancing and it's grinding. And I remember, I think it's Along Came Polly. No, the other one. There's another movie with Ben Stiller and Jennifer Aniston. Right? Which one? Yeah, and so she's like grinding on this sexy Cuban guy at the club, and Ben Stiller gets jealous, and she goes, "It's nothing. Stop being so ridiculous. It's only salsa." And I was like, "Wow." You know, that's the representation we've had, and that's the stereotype. And when you look around, there's not much to argue that, because the dance continues to be propagated that way. And when you go to Latin dance events, the women hardly have any clothing on. Everything is grindy, more so now with bachata, and everything is super grindy. And that's kind of all that was there. And I found those stereotypes kind of minimizing and not flattering to the culture at large. So I wanted to do something different, and I wanted to show sophistication in Latin dance and the possibility of using it without having to contort it to accommodate contemporary dance and ballet ideas, but to borrow from those disciplines the sense of communicating the way film can communicate ideas, kind of hidden ideas that a person that has experience with film and deducing film and how things, messages are put forth in film, could read into and analyze and have discourse about. And that doesn't really exist in Latin dance. You kind of get what you get, and that's it. Shaky, this is cool. You always get, this is salsa, this is, that's what I always say, that when you see salsa on stage, you're basically seeing, this is salsa, this is salsa, this is salsa. It's the same thing with rumba. This is rumba, this is rumba, this is rumba. You're getting, this is what it is, this is what we do, this is how we do it. And it doesn't have that that usage of the art form as a language to then talk about the world more in a large sense, in a more universal sense, where I can, you know, it's like putting the Afro-Latin goggles on and now viewing the world through the Afro-Latin goggles, using it as a language, you know, so that I don't have to just show you what Latin dance is. I can actually talk about life through the medium of Latin dance and to construct choreographies that allow for that to happen, so that there's more sophistication inherent and that we can get away from those paradigms that I feel are so socially hurtful to us. So we ended up starting to do large format, half-hour pieces instead of the regular four-minute piece, which allowed me to use the gamut of rhythms involved. So I can choreograph a bolero, I could choreograph a guajira and a son montuno because I didn't have to impress people in 3 minutes and wow them and get their blood pressure up in 3 minutes. I could have peaks and valleys in the during the course of this composition, and it gave me access to all those rhythms, and it brought back the family that salsa was supposed to kind of be the umbrella term for, as opposed to this singular thing that we say this is salsa. Salsa was an umbrella term. The only reason that I use Afro-Latin funk is because salsa doesn't have the meaning it used to have. It's kind of the singular thing that is salsa now. It doesn't imply cha-cha-cha anymore, which it once did. It doesn't imply bomba en plena. It doesn't imply guajira guaracha and son and son montuno. Mozambique, Afro, those things aren't implied anymore when you say salsa. Salsa becomes this very, the single use of the guaracha rhythm mixed with jazz in the form that it appeared in the late 60s and the 70s. And so to get back to that family concept of all those rhythms being part of that and part of that expression, you know, we gave it a broader label that people had to ask about, and it allowed us to get past their Latin dance defenses, because the high arts community, the second you say Latin dance, you're already dismissed, you know? They won't give you the time of day because Latin dance exists there. I even considered removing Latin Dance Company from the title of the company just to have a chance, because it's so ill thought of in the arts community. Because they really haven't been given the opportunity to see something with that sophistication. So we were the first Latin dance company with that large format to do 2-hour actual performances in a theater where people paid tickets and sat down. We were the first Latin dance company to dance at Lincoln Center, the first Latin dance company to dance at Jacob's Pillow, which is a huge dance entity. There's a documentary about a German dance company, and the whole point of the documentary is them trying to get to Jacob's Pillow, to get accepted at Jacob's Pillow. So, and a woman told us afterwards that she had been at Jacob's Pillow the entire 2 weeks, and that was the first standing ovation she had seen, was our performance. I'm just saying. No, but many historical things happen, but those historical things, unfortunately, because the way things move in terms of culture and pop culture and what is hot and what people are doing and where people's attention is, those things have to have a sustained push from several sources in order to really gain the type of traction that I had envisioned initially. And it was difficult to make a lasting an impression that could be then compounded with different entities kind of pushing the same message. So those things kind of exist, and they were done, and they're there. And we continue to find new ways to present the work to get it to more eyes. But that was like, it's not as much my life's work as it was a few years ago, but it was my main mission, was to just get people to recognize it as something that had the potential to be sophisticated and respected at the level of any other art form.
Yeah, so yeah, that's great. So the you see the progress in that path that you took and do so much to continue with that, right? So you see the progress, like more recognition for this type of
recognition. Yeah. But the thing is that the salsa community, uh-huh. Continues even more powerful. There's almost it's like the universe, you know, answers back, you know, and the salsa community has become more stereotypical. And because of the popularity, that stereotype is being propagated a lot faster than I can alone propagate the contrary, you know? And so it's like I felt for a moment, for a couple of years, that we were making great headway. And then you feel like the salsa scene comes back and kind of envelops everything. And it has a different appeal because the young people want to do that. The young people don't want to sit and analyze something sophisticated. And, you know, that's for the adults and the non-Latinos that aren't, you know, that we're the only, there's a strange dynamic, I think I might have mentioned this to you, but we're the only ones that perform for almost exclusively other dancers and performers that are already involved in what we're doing, right? It's a very strange dynamic. It's not like musicians that are only playing for other musicians, right? But almost exclusively when we perform, we're performing to a room full of people that are already involved in what we're doing, even at the level of just being interested in our music. It's not like we get to present to people from the general public so that for that moment they can experience that culture and that artistic.
So you're
expression.
talking about the U.S. So
I'm talking about the salsa dynamic in general, right? Okay. When you do a performance, you're doing a performance to a crowd full of people who, after the performance, you're going to put music on and they're going to dance, right? They're not people that come there to see the performance and then go back to their lives and maybe have a peripheral interest in Latin music and Latin culture, but aren't directly involved in it, you know, that's what they do. And so you're performing for other people that do, but just like, you know, musicians playing for only other musicians. It's a very unique dynamic where we don't get to perform for the regular people, right? We're always performing for other people who then almost, strangely, we get off the stage and they get on the stage, right? You go to events where you get up and you perform for them, and then you get down and they get up and perform for you. And it's this weird kind of culty, you know, it stays in this whirlwind, and that has a lot of influence, you know, that the kids become quick rock stars, everybody gets a name very quickly, and it's hard to kind of pull talented people with talented minds or talented bodies away from that to kind of help push a different message.
Okay, thank you so much. I have another question for Martinez, but let's let you ask questions before. Yes, please.
First of all, I would like to say that it's really such a pleasure to have all of you here and to have this opportunity to learn from you. And so thank you for coming. It's such a pleasure. Yeah. And if we continue this topic of labeling and stereotypes, so as we know, of course, there are, especially when we talk about salsa, there are so many schools in Europe and in Russia also, and of course, teachers there are mostly non-native speakers of this culture. So the question is, what we as people of different cultural and historical origins can do to support this art, to support the culture that we love, even though we don't always have this opportunity to learn from native speakers of this culture. And also, the other question is, where is this border between evolving of the art by mixture of different cultures and borrowing from different cultures, things, and just ruining and making completely other thing, as it happens with salsa, as it sometimes happens with, you know, swing, the same thing. So this is the question. And also, how can we, how can we support and what shall we do, just to learn to,
Yes. No, it's great. I think that people's curiosity alone ends up being enough to support and to respect. It's when that curiosity goes away and you feel like you've got a handle on it that things start to get a little muddy and blurry. And I think the curiosity, because this has been around long enough that it doesn't belong to us necessarily now. You know, I remember in martial arts, a Japanese teacher that visited to do a seminar told us, you know, you've had karate now for 50 years. It's yours now. Like you're running with this. It's not something that you have to keep checking with us about anymore. You understand this. We have done our best to kind of disseminate it to you the way it needs to be, so you understand it. And so, you know, you've earned the right to continue to, you know, you're a master now, you have your students, you lead them the way we taught you to lead them, and that respect is inherent. And so salsa's been around long enough, and these dances have been around long enough that now everybody, you know, you can trace it back and say it has to be done a certain way, or you have to respect it a certain way, but it is, these things take on so many iterations everywhere you go. Everywhere I go, salsa is a different concept, right? I'm using the word salsa, and every time I say it, it bothers me, but I'm just gonna use it for just to keep things simple. But because I'm ashamed of what it means now, that it's hard for me. I have to kind of like get over my own insecurity of saying the word and being judged for what the word could mean in people's minds, right? But yeah, that curiosity, I know that even just to change context as a foreigner studying martial arts and being curious about the culture that produced this thing, you know, and that my teachers were very adamant about the culture being part of how it was disseminated, that we counted in Japanese, that the etiquette was that etiquette, so that we didn't lose the bedding that the stuff we were attracted to, that maybe we saw in the movies, or that we read in magazines, the stuff that was cool was embedded in this very rich cultural historical setting, and that was very much part of what made it cool at the end of the day, and that couldn't be discarded just so that you can pluck what you thought was cool from it, and then you leave kind of the essence of it gets lost. And at a high level, martial arts has nothing to do with combat. Combat is what gets you interested in it in the first place, and then you start to realize there's much larger implications. And that, for me, dance in every sense, devoid of culture, is not really about the stuff that we think it's about at the beginning, at the start of the day. It's about so much more, but that stuff isn't the sexy stuff that gets you in the first place. You know, it needs to have that sexy stuff to pull you in, but if you pull the sexy stuff out and run with it and pull sexy stuff from all over the place, right, which is what's happening, you just have a collection of sexy stuff, things you think is sexy, things you think are going to make you sexy because nobody has this specific combination of sexy stuff, right? And I use sexy to connote like whatever's cool at the moment, like whatever's sexy for you guys now at this time isn't sexy for me and wasn't sexy for us back in my time, and I'm sure my stuff that was sexy and cool is definitely not cool for my parents, because I sound more and more like them every single day, and I know what they went through, you know? I know exactly why they were saying this stuff. I don't understand what anybody's listening, what kids are listening to nowadays. I don't know what is going on, right? This is music? What? This is not music. When I was young, we had this, and then it's like, oh, shit, I sound like my freaking mother, my father. But that ends up being an issue, and I think the curiosity, and you guys have more than a healthy dose of curiosity to keep you guys honest in terms of, but I don't think you have to go out of your way to try and hold it on a pedestal. It's just about it's the baby in the bathwater scenario, right? Where you're tossing stuff that you have no idea the power and the importance of it in the grand scheme of things, and you're cherry picking the things that you think might be cute at the moment, and that can lead to a lot of distortion and a lot of what seems to be innovation, but a lot of times it's spinning of the wheels because you're not getting what the last generation had to offer in a solid way, so that whatever your addition to that is elevates it and comes in addition to the thing that the last generation did, as opposed to going through the same discoveries over again and thinking you discovered the wheel and not acknowledging the fact that they already did that in the 20s and the 30s, and that we already went through that. There's no need for you to have to go through that again. And everybody thinks, you know, the young people, you know, look what I can do now. It's like, yeah, I was doing that, you know, when I was a stupid young kid. You know, you didn't figure anything new out. You know, if you would have listened and let me talk to you, I could have gotten you through that stage so that you could spend all that energy on the next step, and then we call that reciprocation to the art form, where you're with each succeeding generation, you're somehow giving back to it for what it has done for you in your life, as opposed to the next person getting a little less and the next person getting a little less, and then and you leave after 2 years to teach, and then your people leave after 2 years to teach, and that ends up being like a toilet bowl effect where the art form is worse off for it as it goes forward. And popularization has a lot to do with it, and things get watered down as they get more popular. It's difficult. It's difficult. Things are always at their purest when they're a little underground, and you know, it's a little harder to find it and to do it, because there's more specifics about this is how we do it in this little alcove. The second it starts to spread out, it starts to get watered down, and it's like that rumor situation, that game that you play where... So at the end of the day, you have something that doesn't resemble, and it doesn't have to, but as long as you are acknowledging that it comes from somewhere, and that stuff is important, you know, it's at the end of the day, it's about all of us, not just the people that came from an island or the people that came from a continent. It's about us connecting to all of that, the common history and the common connection, the things that we share in common, not the things that we are different about. And I know there's a lot of importance placed on how we are all different, but I don't think there's enough discussion about the fact that we are so all the same. And that maybe if we were less anxious about that, about being different, it would... What the heck? Beautiful timing. Yeah, I'm sure she does. Yeah, that's it. That's all I had to say. No following that.
So basically, just to make sure, like, just to get sure. So is it better to get somehow attracted to this, to all this culture, even though if it's at first sight you are attracted by a brand or just by marketing and all these things, but still you're somehow attracted, and then you get to know more and more about it. So it's still better that we have so many salsa schools.
No, absolutely. Yeah. There has to be an engine that continues operating to bring people, because very rarely do you endeavor to do something with all these very grand and deep ambitions. It's always kind of like it's calling to you, and you just need to be connected to it. And whatever it is that's calling to you at that moment is not going to be why you're doing it later on. Yeah. Those things evolve, you know, if you're going to stay with it and it's going to be part of your life for any significant amount of time. But understanding that is important, you know, understanding that I'm in the, I call it the opiate phase, you know, you're in the phase where you get a high from jumping around, and, you know, this is what it is for you right now. And a lot of times it ends up being escapism, and you get to run away from your problems for a few hours while you jump around, you know, my old analogy about, you know, I love to dance because I get to forget about my problems. People say that about heroin and alcohol also, right? And dance. if we can't really say dance is life unless it includes all the shit, you know, like unless all that stuff is present and we're really working through that and it's part of what we're expressing and how we deal with those things in life, then you can't really say dance is life. Dance is almost literally not life in that case, right? Because escaping problems are life. The bad stuff is just as much a reality, and things that we have to face and are part of our lives no matter what we think about them. So I think that the question that you were asking earlier about taking bits and pieces, that attraction, whatever it is that you're looking for, whatever you're searching for, and you feel will be fulfilled by these particular elements, that this person does this beautifully, and I'm going to grab that. And that's how everything evolves. Somebody made a decision, you know, a long time ago that they were going to do this, and then somebody else saw it, and it kind of propagated. It didn't come from outer space. It didn't arrive to us on a tablet. It, you know, it somebody made this decision, right? For all of it. Somebody made that decision in history. They were a regular person like me and you that had an itch. They scratched it. Somebody liked the way they scratched it. It lived on, you know? And so that's how things are formatted. And I think that there's nothing wrong with that, you know? It's that within the context of personal development, within the context of development of the art form, giving back to the art form, elevating it, continuing to better yourself, just as a concept, just working on being better in general, you know? That is a possibility, you know? It's a possibility that we can use dance as a practice, because we used martial arts as a metaphor for larger things. And it was that movement facet to meditation, you know? And dance is a meditation. If you're doing dance right, you're not doing it from the conscious part of your brain, right? You're functioning from the subconscious. And the voice in your head stops, you know? And that's all meditation is that you're trying to get that voice in your head to stop translating the world to you so you can experience it directly, as opposed to analyzing what everything means and what you know somebody told you or some experience told you to have certain feelings about, and just interacting directly. And dance, we all experience that dance-wise. And meditation has a function to getting us connected to each other and to the rest of the world. And so that's a possibility in movement meditation, right? That's something that exists there. And I think that's cooler than all the cool stuff that brought me into dance in the first place. But without that cool stuff to get me interested in the first place, I would have stayed doing something else. And so all those things have functions, and their functions, if you look at them, almost parallel our development as people. You know, you have that initial excitement, the childlike excitement. You have that puberty where you're trying to do everything you know in your repertoire. You have to spit it out, regurgitate it, and vomit it all over the place so that you get comfortable with what you know and how to use it, and you have to go through that. But without somebody telling you, hey, this is a phase that we hopefully will get out of, you get stuck. You can, you know, you see it for what it is, you minimize its possibilities. And I just like to be around to say, hey, look, this, you can do this as well. You know, this is also possible. And it's a universal thing. It's a universal thing for us, right? It's not a specific thing that is inherent in people from a certain culture.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I'm starting to wonder how Frankie is, how it's possible for you to tell us every year basically the same things, you know? And I feel like I'm listening it for the first time, you know?
Yeah.
Because we didn't learn the lesson, right?
No, it's cute to understand it cognitively. It's a completely different thing for it to function for you, you know? And we can have the discussion. I always say this, we can have the discussion, and it's fun for discussion. But what I would say to my students is, show it to me, you know, show it to me, because the it's doing nothing in your head. If it can't be manifested, if you're not working on manifesting it so that it is applicable, right, so that you can actually apply it. And Bruce Lee said this, right? He said, to know is not enough, we must apply, right? To have it in your head is cute for discourse, and we can talk about it in almost in retrospect. We can discuss it. I can discuss it with the students so that they know what they went through. But just because you understand it cognitively doesn't give you the ability to manifest it. And I say that music, like, to manifest the thing, right? Can I manifest right now, be physical music, not represent it, not express it, but to bring it into existence right here, right now, into observable existence, right? That type of manifestation. That takes time of having the concept kind of banged into you and having you in stages learn to apply it so that it becomes fully functional for you. And it's a good thing that you are hearing it like you're hearing it for, because I tell my students to do that as well. You should never listen to something. This gives me a few more years of coming here. You should never listen.
Maybe more. Yeah, more.
You should never listen to anything as though you already understand it, you know, because the person that heard it the last time is not the person that is sitting there listening to it this time. And if you can be receptive that way, then everything is available to you. And that's pretty much what I'm teaching, is that to submit to that, right? To open yourself up to that moment, whether it's the musical moment or the interactive moment with a partner or the interactive moment with an audience or other dancers, that submission to whatever that energy is and being open to that and being able to produce that subconscious manifestation, that manifestation of consciousness on the spot, is what we hope to achieve and what I would help someone try to get. And so that takes a while to understand. And so I say it in different languages, hoping to get the people that might hear it differently and something might trigger something different. And I'm going to keep saying it for the rest of the time. It's my only shtick.
Well, thanks for providing these ideas. Yeah, I feel like I'm really influenced by those, like, all the time.
I can tell by the way you're dressing now that...
Okay. You influenced me in your looks also, but in a really weird way, probably. Really subconsciously, you know? Yeah.
I've been called weird before. It doesn't bother me.
Okay, any more questions?
Добрый вечер. Я бы хотел задать вопрос Томасу ДеФранцу про то, как афрокультура повлияла на развитие аргентинского танго. Вот, и можно, пожалуйста, перевод попросить, а то не русский.
The question was about African presence in and influence in Argentinian tango. We are not yet there. Yep.
Thank you for this question. And there's a very famous art historian named Robert Ferris Thompson, who's written extensively about the Afro sort of influences of tango, and he's been very strong researcher of African presence all over the so-called New World, so North America, South America, Central America, and he's produced a book called Tango, and he writes about this. So many of us who are researching these areas are following his lead in some ways, because he, you know, just takes up a lot of space. And if you've ever heard his lectures or been lucky enough to be in his presence, he takes up a lot of space in the room. He's a very big personality. He has a lot of energy. And what's helpful for us, though, is he really believes in dance as being foundational to African cultures, many African cultures. So he helps us think about it in complicated ways. But, you know, so when we get to sort of how Afro-Cuban, Afro-Latino, the things that Frankie is teaching and helping us understand and sort of stay on point about, we're curious and committed to understanding the African influences in these sort of exchanges that produce new art forms in the, you know, in Argentina, in Chile, in Mexico, in Venezuela, and it's a little more complicated than other parts of the planet, like, you know, Australia or even North America, where the native population was simply killed and eradicated. So, you know, the Native American contribution to American popular culture is pretty tiny beyond its representational value. So we see Indians or Native Americans and it has a meaning, but in terms of the actual practices, it's very small. But when you go to Central America and the Caribbean and South America, the Native population and the influences next to the Europeans and the Africans who had been enslaved, you know, the mixing is much more dynamic. So in Argentina, to get to the tango, you have all kinds of forms coming together. What's especially interesting, and here's like a huge area of research that's way underdeveloped for everyone. In African cultures, there's absolutely no tradition of two people dancing en face. We'll have that. It doesn't exist. So all of these innovations that become things like blues dancing or Lindy Hop, these are the result of slave trade, capitalism, marketplace. These are the result of hybridization. They don't exist before. So when we look at tango, we're talking about a form that's invented because of trade routes and slave trade. Like, this form does not exist sort of in a world except the world bound by capitalism. And so maybe this helps us get towards the thing that Frankie's encouraging us to understand, sort of sorrow or loss inside of joy, that they go together. You know, we have these forms because people made really bad choices. And the choices were to enslave people without their will, with no possibility of escape. This is, produces a modernism. The way we have modernism is because of the slave trade. So very bad decisions produce something that's so precious to us and so amazingly important. But it's, they go together, the good and the bad are together in it. So tango, you know, African sort of negotiation of rhythm, of combat as art. Tango is based on two people in combat. It's a combat form that's designed as a dance. And then it, you know, as we all know, is developed by men first in places where there aren't women. It's a male form. It's a fighting dance. And women only come into tango after it's already established as a form. But again, it's not exclusively African because we have no traditions of dancing en face together as a couple. But the part that is quite African is that it's men dancing together. So we have many men dancing with each other. So again, it's a complicated mix that produces the possibility for tango. And then it becomes something very different through time as women come into it. And then, you know, it's a little different than salsa, I think, in terms of how tango means. And it's very spectacular. Tango, in ways that salsa maybe doesn't have to be, tango is kind of always spectacular because the people are able to move in really unexpected ways as one. And tango requires someone watching. It takes three people to tango. There need to be the partners and a witness. It doesn't work with just the partners. You have to have the third vision. And that's really unusual for a social dance form. It's an important part of it. So you can't tango by yourselves. You have to at least imagine someone watching, or you need someone else watching. So it also, that forces the form to be very spectacular, because there's always the sense of someone looking while you're dancing. So I like this question. And again, this researcher named Robert Ferris Thompson has written about tango and its African sort of influences.
This person is really curious about the dance called Condomble.
The Condomble, the dance of the Condomble. The Condomble is quite complicated. This is a religious spiritual system. The Condomble.
Condomble.
Condomble, yes? No, not condomble?
Yeah, something that is has a relation to tango.
Condomble.
Condomble, yes, condomble? Condomble. So this is a religious tradition. The Condomble is a constellation of worship. It's a worship system, and it's like the word is quite complicated because it's the place and it's the practice, and it's the process. It's all of these together, the candomblé. But there are dances associated with the candomblé, and they're religious dances. Some of them are only for women. The candomblé is female-led. It's led by women, but it's led by women's spirit. So men, you know, biological men participate in candomblé in their femininity. So it's a woman's space that includes men. And there are many men who dance in the candomblé, but it's a feminine space. So it's a little different than tango, but it's a religious cosmology. And it stretches all the way across the Americas. So it's all through the Caribbean, through Central America, through South America, and through the United States as well. There are many people who practice candomblé.
There's also candombe, right? That's Brazil. Yeah, like what's the connection between this particular dance and tango? Is there any connection, you know? And like how tango started with this, intricate dancing, you know, comeback.
I see, yeah. Well, one thing that could help us is tango is designed as a social dance. Candomblé is a spiritual process. So candomblé is worship. Tango has no worship background. There's no background of worship in tango. Tango is a social dance that allows us to become each other and, you know, fall in love and, you know, hate each other. But it's a social dance. It's not about a religious ceremony or ritual. Candomblé is spirit worship. So in the candomblé, we're dancing the ancestors and the future and the baby. We're dancing the family. We're dancing religion in candomblé. But in tango, we're dancing this relationship now. It's a social dance.
Yeah, thank you so much. Mm-hmm.
So a question that often comes up is about where are the black people in blues dancing or in swing? And I brought this up with, where's my the amazing translator? Oh, what is her name again? Marcia? No, from the other day. Maria, where? Is she not here? It's okay. Oh, yes, there. And I brought this up the other day, but I wanted to show this. There are very vibrant traditions of hand dancing in the United States. So for African Americans, don't do swing much and don't do blues dancing, but there is really vibrant we call this hand dancing. And one of the forms of hand dancing is Chicago stepping. And like the Big Apple, it's practiced in Chicago, but it's practiced all over the country. It's not just in Chicago. And it's unclear whether it really grew up in Chicago. That's immaterial. It doesn't really matter. But it's practiced like a lot. It's very, very popular. So I wanted to look at some Chicago stepping together, two different things. So we'll start with the Detroit White Party. It's a party where everyone comes dressed in white. This is from this year. And these videos you'll find online, so you can learn some things about it online, but you need to go to start to understand how it operates. So here's Detroit White Party.
Oh,
What's nice about this clip is we see people dancing. So it's not the expert dancers that would be in the movies. It's not the films of Whitey's Lindy Hoppers. But this, from this year, from 2018, is much more like what people were doing at the Savoy Ballroom. Like, people were dancing like this, and then there were Whitey's Lindy Hoppers, the special dancers. So there's always a space for the special dancers who are experts. They're the ones we see in the movies because they were the most spectacular. But these are people dancing. The dancing's very vibrant. People are enjoying themselves, loving it. There's small innovations that are happening. The smallness of the innovation matters. And some forms, you know, some steps that come out of these parties will become sort of standard steps that people will do 10 years later. Let's take a look now at some of the expert dancers from an earlier party doing some Chicago stepping. And what we'll notice here, especially, are the men dancing with the men, which is how the expertise is demonstrated. So as we watch, we can also think about how you hear all the cheering, the participation of the people. This is important. But this would not be, these wouldn't be dancers who practice ever. So the performance is an improvisation because it's still, you know, there's still not really a context for men dancing together except in the specialness of a demonstration. So it would be really unusual for two men to have practiced together before. And this is not about whether they're gay or not. It's just part of the practice of the dance. This clip is fun because another gentleman comes and joins in. Let's jump ahead. And so they dance as a trio for a while. It takes three to...
Thank you.
So I think this helps us connect to the tango, this question. These traditions are still vibrant, they're still happening. African Americans are enjoying hand dancing and partner dancing in all kinds of club atmospheres. Like these parties, they're very popular. Thousands and thousands of people go to the parties, and there'll be a red party or a white party or a yellow party, and they're happening all the time. So these communities and these scenes exist. And sometimes white people go into these spaces and join in, but usually the white Americans who try to go feel very intimidated and, you know, don't stay very long. But sometimes they do. So just to know that these traditions are still going and still growing, even though as we hear the music changes and it's not dancing to swing music at all, the music keeps allowing itself to be more like contemporary music, but it always sounds like old music. It's like always 10 years old or 15 years old funk or something like this.
I have a question to Tommy, because maybe it's a little bit selfish question, because I'm interested in rare art forms of jazz dancing. And I read your books and your book Dance and Many Drums a few years ago. And there is a really interesting chapter about the awkward 40s in New York and about what is called dancing to bebop music. I mean, original bebop music that was as a crisis period after, just in case she doesn't drop my wine. She's too young for that. Yeah, it's usually a normal reaction when people hear word bebop. So, I was inspired because there were a few words that I think were key words to this phenomenon of post-war jazz dancing that wasn't like mainstream. First one was awkwardness, and also that you were using Michel Foucault heterotopia to explain the other space where those who don't have their voice express it on the dance floor. And I think this is very interesting, and I haven't met it ever before in context to dance. That's why I was like really mind blown. So I wanted to ask you about the bebop dancing and like how it was connected to social situation, yeah, of post-war era, and why it was in the underground after swing was mainstream, and why it basically ended as jazz vernacular dance, because we know some examples of UK jazz dancing, yeah, in like that has actually the same mechanism of emerging, of being born. Like it's all social, it's all in the street, it's all because it's black and white, it's all because it's some oppressed voices like have their rebellion constructively, like in the form of art. So yeah, I wanted you to comment on this, because like it was the only one academic text that I met about bebop, and it was like people usually ask me, you dance bebop, are you crazy? Like it's not danceable. And in a book of Tommy I found the sentence, those who say bebop is not danceable seem to be that, how you said that, like writers who like finish their career there, you know, they just say it's dead and that's it, you know. So it's not possible, but you say it's possible, that's why I'm asking.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, by now we know it's very possible, and we dance bebop, you know, but it's 2018. One of my great mentors, I was lucky to work with Honey Coles, and I told you this in the TAP class, and He's amazing, but he and Charlie Atkins were two of the people who, they were a class act, tap dancers, entertainers, and they're two of the people who were very influential, and they said that their careers ended as tap artists when bebop came in, and they said it again and again and again, so it started being written down and people started believing it. They were tap dancers, and they said that their careers ended when bebop came, and this isn't true. But it was a story that helped them, you know, because they're, you know, it was difficult to be an art. It's always difficult to be an artist and figure out how to go from one year to the next. So they kept saying this story, but this really wasn't true. People danced to bebop right as it came into being, but it was hard to dance to, and that was the point. Bebop comes after swing because when swing got mainstream and we had so many amazing African-American musicians, but then, of course, white artists start taking all of the opportunities. And in the United States, this polarization is very strong, the black and white, and then there's Latino, and then there's Asian, and there's Native, but the black and white is the overarching sort of story of the United States in a certain way. Good, bad, it's, you know, sort of true. And so when, you know, Benny Goodman or who else we want to think of, Chet Baker. So when these artists were becoming sort of the most famous swing artists, younger black artists had to have something that other people couldn't do. And we call this later a style nobody can deal with. A style nobody can deal with. So bebop comes out of this, well, if we can't work in the big concert halls because all the white artists are doing that, then we need something that they can't do. And bebop, you know, bebop is really hard to understand, hard to play. It's super fast, tends to be. Even when it's slow bebop, the sort of pulse is even faster than swing. It tends to be, it vibrates higher. So the vibration is super, super high. And the tonalities are not pleasing. They're aggressively abstract. And so bebop kind of redesigned jazz and said, well, it could also be this other thing. But it was still dance music. And it was more like the way that the people who weren't doing swing dance that was fun to watch were dancing in this other kind of abstract way. And so bebop and this kind of abstract dancing grow up together. And awkward is a nice way to, you know, kind of describe it. It's awkward dancing. It's like the eccentric dancing from a generation before, but it comes back as bebop dancing. And in that essay, there's also this idea of how do you learn to dance? And, you know, so when you go to the Detroit party that we looked at, you know, it's not like you can do that just because you want to. You have to practice. So people are practicing at home, you know, that or at home or in the military or, you know, maybe in the school locker room, but there's got to be the awkward time where you're practicing before you're actually dancing in a larger public or sort more public sort of commons. So the awkwardness was also about how people had to figure out how to dance with bebop and how bebop can inspire people to dance, because again, it goes back and forth. So trying to think about that, like the commons that was created then. But if we look at tap dance, for example, tap went from being simply fast to being really abstract in bebop. And in bebop is where we have the roots of rhythm tap. So rhythm tap starts to develop alongside bebop in response to and to help push bebop forward. This is how we get to rhythm tap. And before, you know, we don't have rhythm tap before it because we have tap dancing that's more like what I was teaching the last 2 days, that's following the rhythm and responding to it. But in bebop and rhythm tap, you're initiating rhythm and kind of like leading rhythm into new directions through your dancing and through response to kind of abstract sort of licks. So that's part of how the music is different and the dancing had to be different because of it. But people danced to bebop as it came through in the nightclubs and as tap dancers. And then it really didn't solidify into rhythm tap until like 10 years later. You know, we get people who are really say they're rhythm tappers. And then by 20 years later, by the time you get to the late 60s and the 70s, rhythm tap is really clear. You know, and then by the 80s and 90s, it's its own form that most people are practicing now.
wanted also to ask, like, is there any development in general of these rare art forms into the future? Because, like, what I saw in the videos that we have really few, yeah, about this awkward period of jazz dancing when it was, like, dying, actually. Because, like, what is jazz was also questioned because there are no limits of a genre. As in music was involving as and dance couldn't respond. So, yeah, was it something about, like, really body dancing, or was it about the attitude? One of my teachers, like, told me, if you want to dance bebop, you have to think Snoop Dogg. Because it's all about attitude. Snoop Dogg. Yeah. Like, if you want to dance bebop, you have to think Snoop Dogg, because it's all about attitude and has little to deal with the moves, you know, like it used to be in swing, for example.
I see what you mean, yeah. So it's not about, you know, so swing became something that was defined by shape and actual steps. But again, it didn't start that way. It started about relationship and, you know, again, relationship and social life around. And bebop, you know, bebop, I don't know if I'd say angry, but compared to other forms of black social dance and black music, yeah, it's angry and aggressive. It's definitely nonconformist, so it's more like non-binary, we say now in terms of like gender, we might say non-binary. And bebop is like that. It's not, it's hard to grasp. It's not one thing, and it's particular. It's very bebop, and bebop dancing, I think, is very concerned with not being easy. So, you know, even in the short video I showed, that was a Thelonious Monk version of All Alone that then we treated and turned into something else. But working with Monk helps, because Monk heard music and then realized it in such unusual ways. Like, he would refuse to let it be obvious. He would always push it to some other place, and bebop does that. I don't know if Snoop Dogg does that. Yeah, but I think Snoop Dogg is pretty clear in his attitude. And if we smoke up, we'll be happy. Is like Snoop Dogg. But but there's definitely this a kind of sense of aggressiveness in bebop that you will hear and see us. We won't disappear. Bebop never recedes. Bebop is in front. And swing can sit back. You know, you can sit back and swing. But in bebop, it's going to be in the front. So I don't know. That's interesting. Thank you.
Okay. Do you have any questions? I have a question for Denise Adu. Oh, you have a question. Okay.
Hello. So this is a question to the whole panel, because I would really love to hear all of you share your amazing wisdom. And thank you so much for this incredible weekend. My question is about how are you listening to be the channel? How are you listening to produce the dance that you're dancing? How are you listening to create the music that you play? I'm very interested in this from our discussion, Frankie, about how you were saying that you tell your advanced students to listen from their belly, is it? Would you please share something with us about this?
Start with Annelys, because I love the confused face she has. All right, so I'll start quickly then. I was mentioning in one of the workshops that I ask the advanced students to kind of perceive music from their belly instead of with their ears and their head. And it's just a transition of the cognitive brain and the intuitive brain, or responding intuitively and more with your entire body than just with your ears, or interacting with your entire body instead of with your ears. So I think an example is in martial arts, they ask us to widen our gaze. Does that make sense? In other words, not to focus on your opponent the way you would focus on something that you're normally looking at, but to turn your gaze into a kind of more general gaze than a specific gaze, right? So I don't focus on my opponent, I focus on everything very widely, right? So I'm not looking directly at them, keeping them in focus. I'm almost like when you're zoning out, you're taking in a larger field of vision. What this does is it kind of has a phenomenon called synesthesia or a concept called synesthesia, where we have our senses are connected. And there are people that are called synesthetes that have this in adulthood in a very strong way, where they will hear sound and it will manifest as taste or color. They get this kind of cross-wiring of information in the senses. We all actually have this to a certain degree, and we have it more as children than we do as adults, from what they've been studying. But for whatever reason, synesthetes retain this in a very powerful way, usually in one, two senses stronger than anything else. But this idea that if you are without sight, for example, your other senses will compensate to pick up the slack in terms of you getting a feel for your environment. And that happens in a profound degree in someone who actually loses the sense, but it actually happens to us all. If we turn one sense down, immediately your other senses become more alive. You know, you are able to be more sensitive with your skin if you're not focusing your eyes directly, you know. And so in martial arts, the idea of being sensitive to changes in your environment rapidly, instinctively, intuitively, requires that you don't engage one sense over the others, that you have a sort of general sensitivity with your body so that you are sensitive on a scale as opposed to in a specific way, relying on a specific thing. So if you apply that to the ear and to music, and because our instrument is our body and we want to be sensitive to how we're affected by music, and this is always a late stage thing because you want to get somebody to learn to how to hear music first, how to get into the layers of music, that the ear has to be fine-tuned a little bit to kind of dig into what's going on in the multi, especially with super polyrhythmic styles of music. And so you know I give them exercises to get them to get the ear afincao, we would say, you know, to get the ear tuned. And then later on, when that's all functioning and they're able to kind of follow music and even produce music and add their own music, then I call it asking permission, where you start to get to a point where you are opening yourself up to being moved subconsciously, unconsciously by the sensitivity that you're producing in your body in a large sense, as opposed to you trying to disseminate and pull out rhythms or create rhythms in a cognitive way on the spot. You're allowing the moment to dictate what's happening to you rhythmically in a general sense. There isn't just the music that exists audibly, but also the music that you're manifesting visually, and the way that those two things kind of play off each other with whatever else is happening in the moment, whether it's your feelings or the environment or other factors that may be presenting themselves. All of those things kind of coalesce to manifest as this moment, a representation of this moment in a rhythmical sense. So, but those are stages of kind of getting practice at dealing with music and responding to it in different levels of iteration. I always go in this spectrum. You have to learn how to hear it first. Then you have to learn how to follow it in a specific way, follow what the music is doing, know where how it's structured and what's possible within the structure. Then you bring your own music, right? You jam with the band, so you are not following them. You're giving your contribution that fits with what's happening there, but it is your contribution. You bring your instrument and you sit in with the band to jam with them. And then ultimately you are all of it, right? You are the music. There's no music that exists outside of you. There's nothing separate. The trinity of the dancer, the dance, and the music, those lines start to blur, and there's only one fluid thing that's being acknowledged and manifested. So that's my thingy, majengi. I'm trying to...
Like the, yeah, I was really speaking about the, yes, I was really impressed with the music that you chose for the performance. I really loved it, and I wanna explore more of this track. Actually, it's
Thank
just
you,
a
yeah.
side lined comment so from me. But Annelys,
caso muy particular, yo realmente soy un poco atípica, ¿no? Porque yo escucho diferentes músicas, ¿no? Pero a mí, o sea, de primera impacto, yo casi nunca siento nada. Es como un poco fría, ¿ves? Necesito escuchar varias veces para que algo me llegue. O sea, como la energía es como un proceso que pienso que es un poco tardío, ¿no? Y después de esto, más bien como... sentimientos que van surgiendo desde dentro de mí, es como la energía. Siempre trato de buscar, no sé, o un efecto o un sonido, es como, no sé, o un juego, y a partir de ahí se voy de cómo desarrollando. Pero realmente para mí es difícil porque yo escucho una música y la vuelvo a escuchar y me gusta. Y yo digo, ¿por qué me gusta? Mira, ahora mismo yo estaba escuchando su música y digo, ah, eso me gusta. Pero no sé, ¿por qué me gusta? No sé, es algo raro, ¿no? Y después voy entendiendo poco a poco, ¿no? Y buscando como matices, ¿no? Creando algo. Pero siempre viene desde dentro. Increíble, para mí, yo, como mi laboratorio, ¿no? Interno, siempre a partir de mis dedos, ¿sabes? Es como, ahí voy buscando la energía. Y después eso va como de aquí, va subiendo, hace una pausa dentro y entonces después como yo puedo sacarlo afuera. Sí.
На этом мы переведем. Анелис рассказывает, что она немного в плане слушания музыки, у нее запоздала реакция, то есть она слушает очень разную музыку, но чаще всего она не сразу доходит до нее, то есть ей нужно послушать там какую-то песню, музыку несколько раз, прежде чем какие-то у нее начинают эмоции возникать внутри. И интересен процесс, то есть у нее изначально все как-то с пальчиков начинается, с пальчиков ног, потом вверх идет волна, немножко внутри здесь задерживается, и потом вот она каким-то образом выплескивается. Вот так вот.
English? Yeah. Okay. So she was saying that she is a little bit atypical in she finds herself a little rare in the way she interacts with music, and that when she hears music, she usually doesn't. And I think what she's trying to say is that she's not aware of what's happening to her, but she feels a little bit cold towards it. She likes it. She doesn't understand why it's moving her, and because what's happening to her is kind of not. It's not conscious. She's not conscious of how it's affecting her. And so she needs to listen to music a couple of times until she starts to get a reaction to it. And that she says that reaction kind of starts in her toes, and her toes will start to kind of just, you know, start to get involved, and that will move up into, she actually has the sensation of that moving up into her body, and then she can connect to it. But that it's not something that's innate and that she immediately feels. It's something that almost she has to allow to develop in her in a natural way. I find this super duper interesting, super duper interesting, because I think the reason she describes it the way she describes it is because she thinks she's supposed to be aware in some sense of it in a specific way. And so she's describing the subconscious process that's happening to her and the way music affects her. And I think the awareness of that is super, super intuitive, you know? It's happening to her because it's happening to her, not because of any way that she approaches it or any philosophical ideas. Teamwork. Teamwork.
Я плюс-минус понял вопрос, но решил уточнить на всякий случай. Те, кто были на классе, уже поняли, что музыканты по-другому слушают музыку, похоже, что чем танцоры, поэтому могу сказать за себя, что... А, окей. Вот, поэтому так и есть. На самом деле, в моем случае... Есть несколько вариантов, когда я слушаю музыку. То есть чаще всего, когда я жарю картошечку, я не слушаю музыку. Это же понятно. То есть бывает, я слушаю музыку, которая мне нравится, которой я восхищаюсь. И есть музыка, которую я слушаю для того, чтобы научиться чему-то и что-то взять для себя.
So those who were in Dennis class, remember that there are a few ways of listening to the music, of perceiving the music by musicians, because musicians are professionals in producing the music, so they have their own special ways of also listening to it. There are two ways, for example, when you fry in potatoes, like you just listen to it, and one is when you close your eyes and when you listen to every detail that is in the music. Yeah, and just like we today in class, right? So one type of music also to admire, and one to learn something in order to later on reproduce and to be a better musician and better player.
Я расскажу больше про второй вариант, когда я слушаю музыку, от которой хочу что-то взять и чему-то научиться. То есть первое, что приходит, я слушаю какую-то мелодию, это исполнителя, и чаще всего я слушаю один альбом один месяц в среднем. То есть у меня в айфоне много альбомов, но чаще всего я слушаю один и тот же альбом один месяц. Не знаю, кто-то делает так. Вот. И после этого выбираю одну мелодию, которую слушаю еще какое-то время. К тому моменту, когда я прослушаю эту песню, я практически знаю наизусть все партии, и включая партии трубы. Поэтому я и слушаю эту песню, но это шутка. Вот. И могу сказать, что в целом технология, как обучиться музыке джазовой, она очень эволюционировала, хотя джазовой музыке всего 100 с небольшим лет. Но самым эффективным способом до сих пор является тот, который вы слушаете и повторяете, как ни странно.
So for me, I would like to talk, that Dennis would like to talk about the second type of perceiving the music that he listens to learn something. It's, for example, he has a lot of albums in his phone, but he's listening to one album during 1 month. He's listening just to this album, listening carefully and remembering what's going on in the music. Then he chooses, for example, one track that he is going listening all over again. And then he can include these parties, parts of, for example, of trumpet parts into his like playing. He doesn't know whether anybody else doing this, but like these are the ways. And also technology of learning and learning how to play jazz are evolving because we live also in 2018. But one of the most efficient is when you just listen and repeating. Yeah. So Dennis now is going to put one song and play the parts of a trumpet that he has been learning for some time. It's a track by Nicholas Payton, who now states that just died. But he's saying that he knows the notes and he has a degree and he's leading the band in the university. Yeah, and. One of these ways to learn is to listen and to reproduce. So this is one of the ways, and this is this track by Nicholas Payton.
Thank you.
So I was playing this to explain that I didn't learn this part that I was playing as a piece, as a song. It means that I was just listening to it all over again, and I remembered the solo, and this helped me to reproduce it in order to imply to my playing. So it happened in March this year, so maybe it's second time I'm playing this part in my life ever.
Песни, которые мне очень нравятся, они запоминаются надолго очень.
And those songs that you really like, you remember them forever. That's it.
А у меня, если можно, есть вопрос к Денису Аду, очень короткий. Вот вы наверняка в множестве концертов принимаете участие, где люди танцуют. Вот какой особенно танец или, скажем, какой-то вечеринка или где-то, где танцоры были бы наиболее органично с музыкой вот воедино связаны. Можете что-то прокомментировать на эту тему из вашего личного опыта? Вы же смотрите со сцены, как эта энергетика вся работает.
Well, да, конечно.
Sorry, I was just asking about this connection with the music and dance. If Denise Adu has any, like, has an experience of witnessing, like, the closest connection between the music that they were playing and the dancers that they were watching.
Я уже рассказывал несколько историй на классе, но могу сказать, что я в основном играл на различных сальсо-вечеринках, сальсо-фестивалях, и для меня самое большое откровение в танце танцоров, которые я видел, происходило на вот таких, можно сказать, вечеринках автопати, не на самих главных сценах, где играет большой бенд и все танцуют, а именно в маленьких клубах. Вот сейчас можно заметить, пары танцуют, которые видят друг друга впервые, и не танцуют с таким ощущением, как будто они прожили жизнь вместе. Вот. И из такого, что приходит на память, это я был в Варшаве на фестивале, уже не помню, как он называется. Там было... Наверное. Были там два раза с дислокадос. И вот на одной из такой вечеринки я видел вот пары с разных стран. И даже, возможно, не понимая друг друга, хотя, скорее всего, понимают. Но они танцевали так, как будто они действительно готовили этот танец. И это было удивительно, действительно.
So for me, most of the revelations and most of the hardest impression, not the hardest, but brightest, you know, strongest impressions that I had is people that were, for example, dancing on salsa festivals that, I don't know how to translate Dennis or I, that Dennis was playing, okay, with Dislocadas, with Ukrainian salsa band. And the most of interesting things were happening after parties, but not in the main parties where the big band is playing and everybody's dancing. And also one of the most interesting and inspiring things is that those people who even don't know each other, who meet for first time in their life, they dance as if they have lived life together, and they actually understand each other. And for example, this happened in the Warszawa festival that we don't remember the name, where these Dislocadas were playing, and this was one of the brightest impressions, that this power of dance language when you understand each other.
Еще один момент, который я запомнил, это на одной из вечеринок в Нью-Йорке, когда я играл с Эдди Торресом Мамбо Кингс, и вышел его сын. Вот это было второе, наверное, такое впечатление. Он танцевал один и произвел очень большое впечатление на меня, его танец. Хотя это тоже была маленькая вечеринка, на самом деле, да. Вот, но, конечно, он подготовил этот танец, но Это было настолько музыкально, и было очевидно, что он знает музыку просто наизусть, потому что, ну, это видно сразу, когда человек знает, что он танцует.
Another impression was in New York when Dennis played with Eddie Torres in Mambo Kings, and when Eddie's son went out to perform, and it was a prepared choreographed number, unlike those that we mentioned before, like in salsa congresses when it's improvisation and social dancing, and it was really great because you always see when a dancer knows the music and actually a dancer knows what he's dancing.
Okay, thank you so much. Okay. I wonder if
Я по-русски скажу, просто чтобы не тратить время. У меня вопрос к Фрэнки. Ну, наверняка все знают, да, кто такой Эдди Торрес. И у меня вопрос к Фрэнки Мартинесу. Как вообще Эдди Торрес повлиял на его отношение к танцу, если повлиял? Вот. Ну, вот в этом и заключается вопрос, да?
Okay, the question was about Eddie Torres, and the question is for Frankie Martinez, and what was the influence, in which way Eddie Torres has influenced you as a dancer, performer, so on, right?
Да, просто Эдди Торрес очень такая культовая личность в мире танца, да. Вот лично у меня не противоречиво, просто как вообще Фрэнки относится вот к личности Эдди Торреса и повлиял ли он на его вообще вот ну сознание и видение?
Эдди Торрес is a cultish figure, right? A cult figure, right? Cult figure. And the question is, in which way Eddie Torres as a cult figure influenced you?
As a cult figure?
This person was, yeah, emphasizing that, like as a cult figure.
Oh, okay.
We're going to have to talk about this after, brother. I want to get to the bottom of where the question's coming from. I'm not sure what he means. Eddie Torres was my teacher, right? Was my dance teacher. I danced with Eddie Torres for 4 years. My introduction into this came through Eddie Torres. I will always state that. The fundamentals that I teach, I have an aversion to being abducted by aliens. So when I hear strange stuff, I pause
That's
quickly.
A coffee machine.
Oh, okay. I didn't recognize it as one of our earthly sounds. Anyway, so he was my teacher. And I think that because I was under his tutelage, I have a little bit of a different perspective in terms of the cult status and all that stuff. We held Eddie in very high regard, but Eddie wasn't, at the time that I was dancing with him, Eddie wasn't known. And at the time that I was traveling, when I first started traveling on my own, when I would mention that Eddie Torres was my teacher, people didn't know who he was. They knew who I was, and they didn't know who he was. And then after I stopped traveling, because Eddie had problems with his back and wasn't able to travel, and the traveling thing didn't start until 97 with the Puerto Rican International Salsa Congress. That's the Congress that started the Congress concept, right? And so we didn't participate in that until 99 with Eddie. But I had gone in 98 to see it on my own because a friend of mine had gone the year before the first year. And she told me I had to go, dancers from all over the world. You get to take workshops, see shows from people all over the world. And all we knew was our little Eddie Torres community in New York, right? What was happening in New York. But the cultism comes with, and I think we were having this discussion earlier, is that Eddie is right now the closest thing that we have in terms of connection to the traditions of the past, because of just kind of his age and how long he's been doing it, he is a bridge for us to the times that we have no access to. And he was literally a bridge in the sense that he was one of the only people that continued to dance Latin dance when Latin dance kind of started to disappear, when the Palladium kind of stopped operating. And disco became very popular, and Latin hustle and Latin jazz, and that whole era is when Eddie came up. And yet he, with all those influences, he still maintained the mambo side of the movement. When people had stopped doing it, the clubs weren't functioning the way they did before that, and there were specific clubs that were hot, but it was a much smaller community than it was when the Palladium was hot, and after, when the whole boom in the 90s, when that kicked back in. So that bridge is kind of the bridge to the tradition. So people looking for mambo, like an authentic mambo, the closest thing they have is Eddie. But he wasn't around in the Palladium era, right? Eddie was born in 1950. And so he would have been, he started dancing when he was 13. And that meant we're talking about 1963 now, which means he was a child when the Palladium closed down, and he wasn't old enough to be in the nightclubs until the late 60s. So he was coming in as disco and those things were kind of changing, and his influences were those things. And so he kind of occupies this pocket of time where there was a dip in that popularity. Also because he connected with ballroom teachers who were continuing to teach Latin dance in a standardized way, in a super kind of stylized way for competition. And those dancers knew how to count music and count their steps. They were more formally trained dancers with musical understanding. And so one of his mentors taught him how to count and taught him to play a little piano. And so he started to formalize the street dance that you before had to kind of get by being there through osmosis and trial and error. He kind of standardized it to a form that was now, it was possible to disseminate this now in a broad way to people that didn't have access culturally or just regionally. And so for the people now, he is that access to the traditional stuff, because you have kind of these two schools of thought where you have the stuff that's like super abstract and the tricks and the super dynamic kind of formal ballroom influenced side, and then you have the people that want the real stuff, and their idea of the real stuff is the stuff that Eddie does. Even though when we think about mambo, we're talking about the Palladium in terms of the real mambo, but you can't pin down a real mambo. There's it was a time and people and everybody that was dancing mambo at that time had their thing and their way of doing it, and there was a certain feeling alive there, but there wasn't anything that was standard that you could say this is Palladium mambo and that's Palladium mambo. So yeah, that's the cultishness. In terms of my influence, the structure was passed on to me, and he gave me the tools that I needed in order to, take that system and take it to all the places that it was implying or pointing to. And it was one of the things that he kind of asked of us. He said, I can't, I've given you all I can give you. Now you have to go and take it and find your voice and turn it into, your personal expression. In terms of him as a figure, I was already established in terms of how I wanted to be a man from earlier teachers in my life in martial arts and in Zen. And so by the time I got to Eddie, I was already an adult. And in terms of the status of it, Eddie was just the new sensei, we knew what we were doing was special and that nobody was doing it the way we were doing it around the world. And we knew that he was responsible for that and we respected him for that. But I had learned that type of respect as a child with martial arts instructors, and there's a reverence that's there, but from a distance, you know, it's never casual and buddy-buddy. It's always a certain level of respect. So I'm not seeing it from outside, and I don't have those goggles of the awe of Eddie as this distant figure. I was in Eddie's house. I've been with Eddie's family, watched Eddie's videos in his house. I've driven Eddie's car. So I know Eddie, I know Eddie. It's like you live with somebody, you don't know them till you live with them. But that the mystique of that now is kind of that, the bridge to those traditions. And now that he is so accessible and traveling so much, it's that access to what they call the real stuff, you know. That's all I can speak. I don't know if that's what you were aiming at or what, but yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So do we have time for more questions here? So the question, the question is like, you all, yeah, all, oh, yeah.
The question is as long as some of the answers.
Well,
it's intimidating.
Well, it's about a show number. Like every time people like you are invited to teach the event or Congress, something like this, it usually involve, usually the show number is involved into the structure of the camp, you know, so you have to show what you're teaching and show off. So what is the intention for preparing the show number, whether it's like a show your physical abilities or show the musicality, maybe the music moves any of you to start like thinking about what could be performed? Like what is the foundation for the show number at the certain event? The events that you have invited to teach at? To everybody? Okay.
I haven't been looked at like that by a woman in a long time. Empiezo yo? Well, for me, my thing is very specific. It's not. I think at a certain point there was an entertainment element to it for me, as there is usually. That's the usual thing where you're, and a lot of times it's kind. It was at the beginning. It was to sell the workshops. Like you get up there and you show what you can do, so that people will want to study with you. And to a large degree, that still exists. I think in my world, and not in my world. In the salsa world, that you get up there and you show what you can do to separate yourself from everybody else, so that you will be in demand and you can market yourself and you can have a career and be a young superstar and make money and make a living doing this. So there's an advertising element to it. But for me personally, at this stage in my life, it is much more, number one, a practice for me, in the sense of that connection that I was talking to. It is one of the higher levels of practicing connection and non-separation between an individual or individuals and a room full of observers, right? In a context where you're literally in opposition to each other, you know, there could be, and there is in a lot of, whether it's subconscious or conscious, there is a feeling of going out there and confronting the public's eyes, and you're standing there squared on each other. And what you usually get is an aggressive response to that in terms of, like, you know, you get slapped in the face with the performance, you know, this is me, bam. And it's kind of, my thing is more about putting us all through an experience, and practicing connection on a large scale in a room full of people. Can I lose myself and have you lose the consciousness that you're sitting in a room physically watching someone that isn't you? Can I facilitate that connection, not only for myself, but for all the people that are watching on a large scale? And it's the kind of more mass application of the kind of connection that I'm talking about in terms of the dancer and the music, and then the dancer and a single partner in front of them, and then maybe a group of dancers, and the community of that creates, and the cohesiveness that takes in order to present something to others outside, and then ultimately the mass of connection, not just with the people that are partaking in the activity with you, but the passive observers also, to put us all through that experience, you know, and to put you somewhere. And that for you serves the purpose of demonstrating in a tangible way the possibilities that I'm trying to advocate and teach on a regular basis. I'm trying to manifest the stuff that I'm preaching in the classes so that you can experience it. And then when you come and talk to me, the three people that come and talk to me afterwards and say, oh my God, I was moved and hypnotized and this and that, then I can say, well, that's part of what I was trying to do. And that's part of the potential that dance has, not just for an audience and a performer, but for everyone, you know, to experience that. Even my classes, the isolations, it's mass undulation, mass rhythmical undulation. We're all connected in this big mass doing these movements together and rhythmical phrasing together, feeling like it's just one person in the mirror doing this stuff. It's all of a sudden you're part of this larger organism. And so that's my thing. It's personal practice at this point, and it's me demonstrating to you so that you can understand the possibilities in a more profound way than me ever explaining it to you, you know?
Bueno, al principio cuando comencé toda esta historia de los festivales, no realmente lo hacía, ¿no? O sea, mi proyección para mi show era un poco como para mostrar, ¿no? Sinceramente, como toda mi habilidad que podía hacer. Pero ya hace ya como unos, creo que 4 años, cambio mi visión. Y siempre que voy a festivales trato de hacer, o sea, mostrar la proyección de cómo lo que comercializo yo, que es un mercado bastante difícil, porque bailar, no sé, tal vez New York, bailar otros bailes son un poco más como abiertos, o sea, un poco más de show, pero esta cosa de la cultura afrocubana es bien cerrada, es complicada y hay muchos tabú. Y para mí lo más importante es siempre mostrar, últimamente, hace 4 años atrás, que no hay diferencia ni de cultura ni de raza, no importa que sean ni cubanos ni extranjeros, y siempre, o sea, como a invitar a la gente que practica conmigo cada día, darles la oportunidad de que ellos también pueden sentir lo mismo que siento yo y mostrar, aunque no sea su cultura, no sea su idioma, pero que toda esa enseñanza se la pueda mostrar a todos los que están frente. Y por eso un poco he cambiado mi visión y yo hago ahora como show más proyectivo, más comunicativo, y mostrarles siempre a los rusos que rusos sí pueden bailar como yo, que soy negra y que tengo la cultura afrocubana.
В общем, изначально в Аннелис, когда ездила по фестивалям, идея была вот показать все свои способности, там, как высоко она может ногу задрать, вольный перевод, простите. Вот, но где-то года четыре назад изменилось у нее видение. Она начала, ну так как из-за того, что афрокубинская культура достаточно закрытая, существует очень много табу, делать шоу не так-то просто. И она начала делать шоу, в которой начала приглашать участвовать своих учеников, например, которые с ней занимаются, чтобы показать, во-первых, дать им почувствовать то, что чувствует она во время танцев, во-вторых, показать нам, там, русским, что русские тоже могут танцевать афрокубинские танцы. Это не зависит ни от расы, ни от национальности, ни от культуры, в которой воспитывались. В общем, это танцы для всех.
Yeah, thank you so much. And you want to add?
Oh, we're gonna where is? Do we need English translation? You got it? Okay. They're doing simultaneous translation.
At English? No. Oh, do you need translation to English? Yeah. So very shortly. First of all, she was. No.
So, yeah. Do we have time? Do we have time to hear Thomas DeFrantz answer to this performance question really quickly? Maybe.
Very brief for me. I want to show what I'm thinking about. So I want to continue the things that I'm working on and share that with who is ever in the room. So I do. In the United States, we have this thing called the American College Dance Association. And I am very often adjudicator or judge for this. And these, so I give responses to 75 dances in 4 days. But before I watch all the dances, there's a concert for the adjudicators usually, and we show something. So it's very similar to the camp. It's a very similar format. And I always show something that I'm working on, that I'm concerned with, and that's what it's for.
Okay, thank you so much. I think the time is now to wind up our beautiful, great talk, and I want to thank you for coming, and thanks, Alina, for inviting me, Fedor and Dima, Casa Latina, for hosting this great event, and The most important thing is, of course, the great teachers that we have today. Annelys, Perez, Castillo, Frankie, Martinez, the great musician, Denis Zadu, and Professor Thomas DeFrantz. Thank you so much.
And thank you. Without you, it wouldn't be possible. So you are our soulmates, and see you maybe next year.
And thanks for our beautiful translator from Spanish. Sonia. See you next year. Yeah.